Well, the day that it came down, I wasn't here, I was in Brussels. And I was there at NATO. And so I'll be very honest with you, besides being happy that it came down, because I was at NATO, my first question is, are we in danger? Because nobody had believed that this would ever come down peacefully. And so being at NATO, and then the very next day we had a big contingency meeting, make sure all the forces were there and everything, because nobody really knew what was going to happen.
The fall of this wall, the collapse, really, of East German state surprised a lot of us.
What surprised me was that it was an unbelievably powerful, dedicated popular uprising which finally did it. It wasn't negotiations, it wasn't American soldiers, it wasn't German economic pressure. It was several hundred thousand people in this country, in this city. On November 4th, 5 days before the wall was open, 500,000 people gathered in the center of East Berlin, Alexanderplatz, and demanded freedom. And that was, I think, the thing that finally set everything rolling.
Was Moscow pulling the rug out from under the regime?
I knew the Russian ambassador in Bonn at that time, and he's written his memoirs also. He told me, he went back to Moscow and said, so what's our policy? And they said, what policy? We have no policy. In other words, the Russians were just as confused as anybody else was.
The East Germans and Egon Krenz saw they were in a lot of trouble. They tried to issue visas. They appealed for people to stay. They essentially tried to reshuffle the deck chairs on the Titanic.
Right, they did. And they couldn't. And there were people, to be totally honest, in West Germany who were trying to help them because they were worried about war. The thing that kept it going was also the idea that if it didn't stay up, there would be war. There wouldn't be debate, there wouldn't be confrontation, there'd be war. And as you know, the leaders of Britain and France were not exactly enthusiastic about this event. I'm not sure they were worried about war, they were probably worried about German competition. But still, it isn't as if the whole world jumped up with joy and said this is happening, because it was such a major, use that overused word, geopolitical event, that a lot of people said, uh-oh, what's going to happen now? Up until then, between, say, 1948 or 49 and 1989, the world was really divided into two camps. They weren't always loyal to one or the other camp. They didn't know they were divided. But the fact is that the whole behavior of countries, whether they be in South Africa, whether they be in Asia, wherever, was determined to a considerable extent by the East-West confrontation, which took place right on this spot. We're paying some of the price, yes. We didn't let things develop freely. Why did we pay so much attention to the Sandinistas in Nicaragua? They could do nothing to us, but they were seen as a tool, as an extension of Soviet efforts for influence in Latin America. Why did the Soviets spend so much time working in Southeast Asia, which was generally friendly to us? There was Soviet subversion going on everywhere there, and the Vietnam War, of course. Why did they do that? Because they thought that if we moved too closely up to them there, that would be somehow destabilizing. I grew up in this era. I was a young diplomat in the beginning and an older diplomat at the end, and we were forever talking about stability and how are we maintaining stability. And I think you're right. I think in the Near East, for example, but also in Latin America, we supported lots of people we shouldn't have been supporting, and it was the confrontation that played a big role in that.